Okay, students, in my previous lecture, I told you about this Gauss law. This Gauss law states that the total electric flux over a closed surface enclosing charge. Here, there is a system of charge. So here there will be electric field. Around these charges you consider a closed surface. This is an imaginary closed surface. The total normal electric flux through this closed surface, it is equal to 1 by epsilon naught times the charge enclosed by this closed surface. Of course, here we consider the medium to be vacuum or air. That's why you have this epsilon naught. If the medium is other than vacuum, I mean if there is some material medium here, then you can take it as 1 by epsilon sigma q. So this is the statement of Gauss law. This Gauss law is very useful to find the electric field at a point due to symmetric charge distributions. So as an application of this Gauss law, first we are going to find electric field at a point due to infinitely long, straight, uniformly charged conductor. So this is the first application, electric field at a point due to uniformly charged infinitely long straight conductor. This is an important question for the examination, board examination. This question was asked many times in the annual examination for 5 marks. So here I consider a straight infinitely long uniformly charged conductor. Here this is infinitely long. This is uniformly charged. As you know, charge resides on the outer surface of this conductor. Here, this is some point O. From this point at a distance R, that means at a point P, I want to find the electric intensity. That means from a uniformly charged infinitely long straight conductor at a distance r, that means at the point P I want to find this electric intensity. See, to find the electric intensity at P, first you consider two equidistant small elements of this conductor. So here this is P1. So at the other side you consider another element P2. P1 and P2 are two equidistant elements of length of the conductor. So here charge being distributed linearly, let lambda be linear density of charge. Let lambda be linear density of charge. As I mentioned, this is a uniformly charged infinitely long straight conductor. This lambda will be same everywhere on this conductor. Now first we shall find the direction of electric intensity at the point due to the charge on this conductor. So the charge present on this small element of length, it acts like a point charge. So this is a small length element. In this small length element, there will be a small quantity of charge. So this acts like a point charge. So due to this charge on this element at this point, direction of electric intensity will be like this, E1. Similarly, due to this element of length, at this point, electric intensity, E2, it is in this direction. See here, these are equidistant, and also these elements are of equal length. So obviously, the charge on these two elements will be the same. This distance is also same. Therefore, the magnitude of electric field due to this element P1 and due to this element P2, it will be same. That means magnitudes of E1 and E2 will be same. But the directions are different. So to find the resultant, here this E1 is equal to E2. So to find the direction of resultant electric field, we shall resolve this E1 and E2 into rectangular components. So this is x direction. This is y direction. So this is negative y direction. So if I take this angle as theta, this also becomes equal to theta, because these distances are equal. So this angle are equal. Correspondingly, this and these two are also equal. Component of E1 along this side, it will become E1 cos theta. This side, it will become E1 sin theta. Similarly, component of E2 along this side, it is E2 cos theta, and here it is E2 sin theta. E1 is equal to E2, theta is also same. Therefore, this E2 sin theta in this direction, E1 sin theta in this direction, they get cancelled. Whereas, these two components, E1 cos theta in this direction, E2 cos theta is also in the same direction, they add up. Therefore, the resultant electric field at this point P, it will be in this direction. Understand? Resultant electric intensity at the point P, it is radially away from this striped conductor. So this is the direction of electric field at the point P due to this infinitely long uniformly charged conductor. So the direction of electric field is radial to the conductor. Radial means along the radius of the straight conductor. So at all points distant r from this straight conductor, the direction of electric field, it will be away from the conductor, and also its magnitude must be same. This E must be same at all points. E must be same at all these points. Magnitude of E is same at all these points. Direction of E is away from this straight conductor. Now we have to get the expression for this E. So to find the magnitude of this electric field at E, so this is the point P. So from the earlier explanation, you learned that the direction of electric field is radial to the conductor, radially outwards from the conductor. Now to find the magnitude of electric field at P, you imagine a coaxial cylinder as Gaussian surface. So here You imagine a closed surface in the form of a cylinder of length L and radius R. So to find E, imagine the Gaussian surface as a coaxial cylinder. So this length is L and this radius is R. See, a surface through which flux is considered, the closed surface through which electric flux is considered, it is called a Gaussian surface. Here this is the Gaussian surface and this Gaussian surface encloses the charge here. So you find the flux through the surface, you find the charge here. By using Gauss law, you compare these two, thereby you will get the electric field at P. Already we found the electric field direction to be radially outwards, like this. So we shall find the total electric flux through the Gaussian surface. Fine. So in the previous classes you got this equation for total electric flux, which is sigma E dot delta S or delta A. Delta S we have represented. So we write the same, we write it in the same way. So this is sigma E delta S cos theta. Here this electric intensity is the same at every point on the curved surface of the Gaussian cylinder. So electric flux is same everywhere here as well as here. That means flux is a constant. Electric field is a constant. So electric field is same everywhere on the curved surface of the cylinder. Therefore E is a constant. And this theta, in this equation, what is this theta? It is the angle between direction of electric field and area vector. That means angle between E and n cap. Here, for this curved surface of the cylinder, n cap is in this direction, E is also in the same direction. Therefore, this theta becomes 0. So E cos 0 degree. And the summation is only for this area, delta S. If you look at this total surface area of this Gaussian cylinder, flux is emerging normally only through the curved surface. There is no flux emerging through this end face. There is no flux electric, there is no electric flux or electric field in this direction. Because electric field is tangential to this surface, to this end face as well as to this end face, electric field is tangential. So we have to consider only normal electric flux, that means electric flux which is perpendicular to the surface. So there is no electric flux through this surface as well as this surface. That means electric flux through this N phase is zero, electric flux through this N phase is also zero. So electric flux is emerging normally only through the curved surface of this cylinder. That means what is the total area of this curved surface? So area of this curved surface of the cylinder, it is given by 2 pi r into L. Because when you open this curved surface, it becomes a rectangle, where this length is L and this length will become 2 pi r, so it becomes 2 pi r L. So this is the total electric flux through the Gaussian surface. Next, charge enclosed by the Gaussian surface Q, this Q is equal lambda into L, because when charge is uniformly distributed or symmetrically distributed, this lambda can be written as total charge divided by total length. Therefore charge can be written as lambda into L. Now you know flux, you know charge. Now you use Gauss law. This phi is equal 1 by epsilon naught times charge enclosed. So E into 2 pi r into L is equal 1 by epsilon naught lambda into L. Therefore this E is equal to lambda divided by 2 pi epsilon naught r. This is the expression for magnitude of electric field. If I express the same thing in vector form, this is lambda divided by epsilon naught into 2 pi r n cap. What is this n cap? It is the direction of electric field. That means n cap is a unit vector directed away from the conductor if lambda is greater than 0. That means charge is positive. On this infinitely long conductor, when the charge is positive, this field is away. Therefore, where n cap is a unit vector, directed away normally, from the conductor if lambda is greater than 0. So this n cap is a unit vector directed towards the conductor if lambda is less than 0. That means charge on the conductor is negative. Now you got the magnitude of electric field and direction of electric field at a point due to this uniformly charged infinitely long straight conductor by using this Gauss law. So this is the first application of this Gauss law. When this question is asked in the examination, first you have to write that the direction of electric field is radially away from the conductor. Next, to find the magnitude of electric field, you consider a Gaussian surface. From the Gaussian surface, first you find the electric flux, then you find the charge enclosed, and then by using this Gauss law, you can find the electric field at a given point. Now, from these statements, you can make out these following points. First thing, this electric field has got a cylindrical symmetry. That means in every point along the curved surface of the cylinder, magnitude and direction of electric field is the same. Therefore, this has got cylindrical symmetry. Second thing, here this electric field is not due to the charge present only inside the cylinder. This electric field is due to the charge present on the infinitely long conductor. Understand? This electric field is not simply due to this much of charge here, but the electric field here is due to the entire charge present on the infinitely long conductor. The third point is, this expression is true for infinitely long straight conductor. In case if the conductor is not infinitely long, if it has finite length, then this equation may not become true due to end effects. That means if this is a finite conductor, then the expression for electric intensity is may not be same, because there will be end effects. End effect means the electric field may not be exactly in this direction due to the charge present at this end and at this end. So you remember these points regarding this derivation. If you are asked to find this electric field due to infinitely long uniformly charged straight conductor, then you do this much of derivation, that is enough. The second application is, electric field at a point due to infinite plane sheet of charge. Here I consider a plane sheet of charge like this. Actually, this plane sheet of charge is perpendicular to the blackboard like this. From this plane sheet of charge, at a point P, I want to find the electric intensity. So, this is a plane sheet of charge perpendicular to the blackboard. This is a point P, distant r from this plane sheet, where I want to find the electric field. If I consider another point equidistant on the other side of this plane sheet of charge here, since this distance is equal to this distance, whatever electric field is here, the same amount of field will be there here also. Further, this being a positive charge, due to positive charge, electric field is directed away. Therefore, here the electric field is in this direction. Here this electric field is in this direction. Now, charge being distributed in the form of a sheet, let sigma be surface charge density. Sigma B surface charge density. At point P, distant R. either side of charge machine electric field is same. Next, to find the magnitude of electric field here or here, we have to consider a Gaussian surface. Here I imagine the Gaussian surface in the form of a cylinder such that the two end faces of the cylinder enclose the point P. So this is one end face of the cylinder. This is another end face of the cylinder. And this is the Gaussian cylinder now. So this charge is enclosed by the Gaussian cylinder here. So to find electric intensity at P, imagine Gaussian surface as a cylinder such that its end faces enclose the point P. This one and this one, these two points are enclosed by the end faces. This is A and this is B. Now you find total electric flux through this Gaussian surface. Therefore, total electric flux through the Gaussian surface, phi is equal sigma E delta S cos theta. Here there is no normal flux through the curved surface of the cylinder. There is no flux in this direction. So electric flux through the curved surface of the cylinder is zero, because the flux is radial, flux is in this direction. There is no normal flux like this. Therefore, flux through the entire curved surface of the cylinder is zero. Whereas there is a normal flux through this end face, there is also a normal flux through this end face. And everywhere on this end face as well as this end face, the magnitude of electric field will be same, because this distance is equal. Therefore, this E is constant and this theta is 0 degree and sigma delta S. So out of this total area of the cylinder, only these two end faces are contributing for electric flux. Therefore, this is E into flux through this end faces. A, flux through the other end face is A, area of this face is A, area of this face is A, and area of this curved surface, it is considered to be zero because there is no flux emerging through this curved surface. So therefore, it becomes 2 times EA, where A is the area of each end face. So if this A and this A both are confusing, in such a case you can write this as M, this as N. You represent both end faces as M and N, A as area of each end face. So there is no normal flux through the curved surface of the cylinder. flux is emerging normally through this end phase and also through this end phase. Therefore, total electric flux, it is E into A plus A plus flux through the curved surface is 0. So 2EA. Next, charge enclosed. By Gaussian surface, Q, this is equal to sigma into A, because by definition surface charge density means charge per unit area. Now you know flux, you know charge, you apply Gauss law, thereby you get expression for electric intensity. From Gauss law, phi is equal to 1 by epsilon naught times charge enclosed. So this is 2EA, this is equal to 1 by epsilon naught sigma A. So you can strike off this term A. Therefore, E is equal to sigma divided by 2 epsilon naught. So this is the expression for magnitude of electric intensity at this point P from this plane sheet of charge. Next, if I have to write this equation in vector form, so it is E is equal to 2 epsilon naught n cap. What is this n cap? It is a unit vector directed away from the plane sheet of charge if sigma is greater than 0, that means charge is positive. So similarly, this n cap is a unit vector directed towards the charge if sigma is less than 0, that means if the charge on the sheet is negative. So this is the second application. Here you remember these following points. E, it is independent of this distance. There is no term of this distance. That means everywhere the magnitude and direction of electric field is the same, it do not vary with the distance. That means due to a uniform infinitely long plane sheet of charge, the electric field is uniform. So E is independent of distance. Second thing is, this electric field is uniform. Due to plane sheet of charge, it is uniform. So this is the second application. The third one, electric field at a point due to a charged spherical shell. This is the third application. So this is a uniformly charged spherical shell. Uniformly charged spherical shell, that means charge is distributed uniformly over its surface. Like this. So let R be its radius, Q be the charge on this spherical shell. Let R be radius and Q be charge on the spherical shell. Therefore, surface charge density sigma is equal to Q divided by A, which means Q divided by 4 pi r square, where 4 pi r square is surface area of the sphere. So this is the surface charge density. So in the first case, I want to find electric field at a point outside the charged sphere here. So here this is the point P, distant r from the center. This is a point P, distant r from the center. I want to find electric field here. First of all, the direction of electric field is normally away from the charged conductor. Because in the properties of electric field lines, I told you that electric field lines are always normal to the surface of the charged conductor. Therefore, this is the direction of electric field at this point P. That means normal drawn to the area and direction of electric field is same. That means E and N cap are in the same direction, therefore theta becomes 0. Next, to find magnitude of electric field at P, you imagine the Gaussian surface in the form of a concentric sphere of radius R. So, to find electric intensity at P, distant R from O, such that R is greater than R, imagine Gaussian surface as concentric sphere of radius R. Therefore, electric flux phi is equal to E delta S cos theta. By radial symmetry, E is the same everywhere. Because this distance being same, E is constant, this theta is by radial symmetry, this phi becomes E cos 0 sigma delta x. So this is E 4 pi r square, because total surface area of this Gaussian surface is 4 pi r square. Next, charge enclosed by Gaussian sphere, this Q is equal, Gaussian surface is Q. Therefore, from Gauss law, phi is 1 by epsilon naught times Q. Therefore, this E 4 pi r square is equal 1 by epsilon naught Q. Therefore, this E is equal 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught Q divided by R square. This is the expression for magnitude of electric field at a point outside the charged spherical shell. We can write this equation in vector form like this. Vector E is equal to 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught Q divided by R square n cap, where n cap is a unit vector directed away from the charged spherical shell if charge is positive, that is Q greater than 0. N cap is a unit vector directed away from the spherical shell if Q greater than 0, that means it is positive. Similarly, is directed towards the spherical shell if charge is negative. So for a point outside this charged spherical shell, electric field is given by this equation. If the charge is positive, this electric field is radially outwards. If the charge is negative, electric field is radially inwards. So this is about electric field due to a charged spherical shell. This question is very important for the examination, which was asked many times in the annual examination. Find the electric field at a point due to a charged spherical shell using Gauss law. It will be asked like that. So in that case, you have to carry this derivation. The next thing is, if P is close to the surface of sphere, that is, this distance R is nearly equal to R, this one, then this is given by 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught Q divided by R square. Then this equation can be written as 1 by epsilon naught into Q divided by 4 pi R square. This Q divided by 4 pi R square is nothing but surface charge density. So E is equal to sigma divided by epsilon naught. So at a point very very close to the surface of this charge conductor here, or otherwise sometimes we say that the point lies on the charged conductor. So charge resides on the conductor, that means on the charge electric field is not well defined. Therefore we consider electric field near to the surface of the charged conductor. In such a case, the equation becomes sigma divided by epsilon naught. So this is the expression for electric field near the or on the charged conductor. In the next case, field lies inside the conductor or inside the spherical shell. That means this R less than capital R. So this is the point P naught. So to find the electric field here, I consider the Gaussian surface like this. Through this Gaussian surface, electric flux is zero because there is no charge inside. Well, one of the fundamental properties of charge is charge always lies on the outer surface of the conductor, like this. So as there is no charge inside the spherical conductor, there is no flux through it. Therefore, electric field is zero. So if P lies inside the conductor, phi is equal to zero, since Q is zero, therefore E becomes equal to zero. Therefore, there is no electric field inside a charged conductor. Not only this spherical charged conductor, if you take any charged conductor, as charge lies on the outer surface of the conductor, inside the conductor electric field will become zero. So if I represent this variation of electric field graphically, you remember these following notes here. The first thing, for a point charge at a distance r, so this is the point charge Q, this is the point P, this distance r, electric field is given by 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught Q divided by r square. Similarly, for a spherical conductor having charge Q over its surface at a distance r, the electric field is given by the same equation. That means the charge on the spherical conductor act like a point charge at its center for any point outside the charged conductor. That means for r greater than r, charge on the spherical shell acts as point charge at its center. That means for any point outside the charged spherical shell, the electric field will be as if the entire charge is concentrated at its center. So the charge lying on the outer surface of the sphere, it acts like a point charge at its center when this point is outside the charged sphere. So this is one thing which you need to remember. So if you are asked to find the electric field due to a charged sphere, you have to use the same formula as of a point charge by treating this charge to be at the center. Next, the variation of this electric field with the distance from the center is graphically represented like this, E versus R. So up to a distance equal to R, which is the radius, the electric field is zero. So near the surface, the electric field is maximum. So if you move away from this surface of this charged sphere, electric field varies inversely as the square of the distance. So this graph represents the variation of electric field with the distance from the center of the spherical shell. So in your syllabus, you have only these three applications of Gauss law. And in the next class, we shall take up some problems in this chapter, that is electric charges and fields.